This chapter was, I don't know about how you all felt, but I felt like it was pretty clear. I'm still, challenged with a lot of these concepts, but at least, like, it seemed more sensible to me, the whole idea of sequentiality and all of that, which apparently Microsoft does not think is a real word, as you can see. It's trying to auto-correct this, but so let me just kind of go through. I'm not making any kind of special, I'm just copying and pasting stuff from the book just to kind of like touch on things. And I put some exercises at the end. And then what I did was, hopefully y'all can see this, is my art studio session. So I forgot, like, you guys are not all R users, right? Or no?
Probably more comfortable with R. I use Python though, a bunch at work. That's mostly because my manager uses Python.
Basically the same kind of idea, yeah. Object-oriented programming. I'm sure there's like a commensurate package in Python that does this, but yeah, so we can play around with this. And this is the feminist, I just set the parameters of the alpha and all this stuff. So this is the feminist, if you remember the example from the chapter where, like, I think it was 9 out of 20, the sample was 9 out of 20 past the Bechdel or whatever it was, the Bechdel, I forgot. So it does some cool stuff. Like it shows us what the prior is, what the scaled likelihood is, what the posterior is, and also it gives us the mean and the variability. And yeah, so this is all really cool. I'm still, like, probably the rest of everybody else, I'm still struggling to figure this all out, but we're moving there. So, all right, so what are the sort of goals of this chapter? It's to balance the kind of, to show how, like, the balance between the prior and the data impacts the posterior, right? This isn't just one or the other. There's, like, a kind of a dance to show that these two things have their own sort of impact. And then we're going to talk a bit about sequential Bayesian analysis. I don't really get into the sequential stuff as much in terms of exercises that I chose, just because it seems like it takes longer to kind of do the sequential thing. First of all, I don't know if people care about this, but I actually did some research on this Bechdel test. There's like a whole website on this, and super cool. Like, apparently, Scooby-Doo movie passes the test, but not a bunch, like the Harry Potter movie didn't make it somehow, which, I don't know. I haven't seen it, but totally irrelevant, not relevant at all, but I thought this was pretty cool. It's actually, I had actually heard this. I had a professor in grad school who was like, he had done a bunch of analysis on like gender issues in film. And he found that, like, check this out. So, like, movies where like the man is nominated for best actor are more likely to also be like nominated for best picture, but if a woman is nominated for best actress, this is like 20 years ago. I don't know what the data says now, but like back in the day it was like this. This is a really interesting one of the things I love about this, I mean, besides the issue of female voices and film, is that it's very objective, right? It's like you have to have at least 2 females in the cast. And they have to speak to each other, and they have to speak to each other about a non-male issue, which that probably is the only vague part. Like, I don't know how you would, like, if a male's name came up in a conversation, but the conversation was really about something else, I don't know how you would code that. But anyway, it's an interesting sort of style of measurement, because it's objective, more or less. I mean, there's issues, but anyway, enough of that. So just the setup is, pi is the random variable of between 0 and 1, which is the proportion of recent movies that pass the Bechdel test. And then we have our 3 friends, the optimist, the clueless, and the feminist. Sounds like a very 21st century bunch of friends. Just to be clear, like, what's the beta 1, which, who is this?
Clueless.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. We don't really know, right? So this flat line means, pick them. It's like a coin. Whatever the Bechdel version of the coin flip is, right, or whatever. So, and then what about this one?
A feminist.
I was thinking. Oh yeah, yeah, yes, 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 yeah. Yeah, that, yeah, that makes more sense. Yeah, 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 that makes way more sense.
I got confused because I was like, well, shouldn't feminists say that women are more, I mean, no, I was like, no, of course not, right? The feminists would say, they, if anything, they were going to be more biased towards saying the lower.
Yeah, and they probably have, like, you could say more information. Like, they probably have, like, a more reasonable prior. Because then, like, on the right, right, it's going to be the optimist, and that's, like, likely unreasonable.
Like, the optimist has never even thought about this issue, but he's just, he or she's just like, happens all the time. But the feminist has, you know, perhaps was considered this, or she has more of what we'll call, soon to be calling, an informative press, right? Mm-hmm. Or, actually, let's assume that I shouldn't assume that, but whatever. Okay, so yeah, just remember, we always kind of merge the issues of binomial distribution with the beta binomial model, and so number of movies that pass the test. So we have the number of movies that pass the test given our little pie friend. we take that and we feed it into the beta function. And so each analyst has a unique posterior model of pi, which depends upon their unique prior, their A and B. So these A and B is the thing that's differentiating our three friends, and they all have the same data. Now, I bring this up, of course, because we're going to get to a place where everyone has the same prior, but different data, which I thought was actually, in some ways, even more interesting, just because I think we oftentimes fixate, or at least I've seen people fixate in the literature that, to the degree that I even understand it, about, you know, this idea of how priors are so, you know, they can be so wishy-washy or whatever, but the data, you know, has its own set of issues, right, depending on how you sample that data and how much. So they kind of bring up this whole issue of prior means versus prior variability, which I'll just point out is kind of brought up in this, I don't know if you all can see this.
Yeah.
So this is the mean, and this is the posterior, right? And so notice how we have variance here. So it's, you know, prior, in the prior, the variance is bigger than the posterior, which makes complete sense, right? You know, the more you know, the less variable your sort of your posterior is going to be. So the authors just talk about this idea of informative versus, I guess the other term was vague prior, right? So the smaller the variability, the more certain the prior info, the more vague, the greater the variability. So I think if I'm remembering, which of the three have the greatest variability?
The clueless.
Yeah, the clueless.
Right. I mean, I think last week we talked about this, and maybe this doesn't have any variability. So I don't know, actually.
Because
they're all the same, right? Sure. So I think actually, I thought it was
yesterday, last week, that we were saying that when it was like a, because like, right, the beta 1-1 is a uniform 0-1 prior. I thought that one had, I thought we were talking about it last week, that one had the greatest variability.
I don't mean to suggest that I'm being certain.
I'm also trying to remember, because I think last week we were both saying to Ron that for example, if this one, like the beta 5-11 prior, right? Like that one we thought had the greatest variability, but I think it would be the beta 1-1 because you're not making any like assumption, right? About the distribution. You're just saying like everything's possible. So I guess then the variance would be larger than in the case of, let's say, the 5-11 one, because there's obviously like it's like kind of bounded, right? Like we're saying that realistically, like probably what, just eyeballing it, like anything probably after 0.5 for pi, like isn't feasible. So like it's a smaller range, I think.
I got a great idea, actually. Let's do this. Okay, so this is the feminist model, right? Let's just do this. I got to change. Sorry, I thought I'd be really clever. Actually, I can just do this. I'll just say, change this to 1. So the actual, the number of data doesn't change. Okay, so, and if you can see this, it's hard to get it to fit into one screen. Yeah. So the feminist has Right. Okay, good. Yeah. So yeah, we can, so this is more variable, right? Yeah. So this is interesting. And then let's just go, since we're already doing this, let's do this. So yeah. So the optimist is just like the variability. Do you understand what I'm doing, Rachel?
Oh yeah. I guess okay. I'm curious though, if we added, instead of being uniform, it was still very likely across from 0 to 1, but maybe just like a small peak somewhere. Would that be greater variability from a uniform model?
So you mean like this?
So that.
What shape are you trying to?
Good question.
Yeah. No. So yeah. Like,
yeah. I mean, the only thing I can mess with really is okay. So by the way, let's okay. So let's do this. If I can, well. So this is, if we just keep the data the same, yeah, so the actual, and this is something I'm going to get to in a minute, like the actual, you know, the prior isn't informative, so basically everything comes down to the posterior, right? So for the peak, so where would you want to put the peak, just out of curiosity?
So I wonder if I could just draw it out. One of my questions for today were, if you guys just know these numbers, so like the beta 115 or whatever, do you guys just know what that would look like? Because I certainly don't.
I have a like more slightly intuitive. I think in the last chapter, what was helpful was understanding like if like where the parameter would lie, right? Let me just go back to it. But it's actually, chapter 3 was super helpful for me.
Alpha refers to it's the number of successes plus one, yes, and then beta is the number of failures or non-successes, isn't that correct?
Yeah, so like it seemed to me like, so when like in like the beginning of chapter 3, I like this like quiz yourself thing about kind of like intuitively understanding like the shapes for like alpha and beta, right? And if alpha and beta are the same, let's just call the parameter like X, right? The parameter X tends to be more symmetric. In the case if, let's say, alpha is larger than beta. So let's say, as an example, let's just say like beta was 10 and, and beta was 5, right? You'd expect.
Sorry. So you want alpha is 10 and beta 5? Is that what you said?
No, I'm not. I'm just like trying to like both explain it. Like, yeah, I mean, do that because it'll then tend to be it'll be more like left how... skewed, right? And then the parameter X would be larger. And then if you reverse that, where alpha is smaller and then beta is larger, you'll get like a right skewed distribution with X being a little bit less than like 0.5, right? In terms of your prior.
Yeah. I can see it. Yeah, that makes sense now how the skewness is. I guess I'm looking now at the difference between the uniform models. So an alpha and beta are the same number. So I guess I drew it out here. I don't know. I have a blur on. Maybe I just put it right on my face.
But, okay. So yeah, this,
it goes from something like this. Now, would this be more variable than the clueless guy?
That would be less variable.
This one here?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because like you're also making, I think it's also less variable because you're making an assumption about the distribution. Like you're assuming that there are certain values that are either not really plausible or aren't plausible. Whereas in the uniform, you're saying that I have no idea what this prior distribution is. So I'm assuming every possible value is possible. So your variance is then, you know, equally probable. So then your variance is going to be larger because you're not making any assumption about the form of the distribution.
Sure.
That's a great point. Yeah.
Great. Didn't mean to take so much time on that.
last
week we like, I said exactly the same thing. Like I was like, I don't understand this and I'm still struggling to look at a beta function with numbers and be like, oh yeah, that shape is like X, you know?
Yeah. I think for me, it's like, it's more helpful just to like understand, not so much like how it would look exactly, but just sort of like, at least for me, understanding like as, you know, alpha and beta change, like what type of distribution am I like going to get? Like, what would like the parameter I'm looking at, what would its value like generally be? Which I think is like, was helpful for me because even like last week, I'm like, what the hell is alpha, like alpha and beta? I'm like, what? I don't really have like an intuitive understanding of like what happens when you change one or the other,
yeah.
Both.
Yeah. So anyway, yeah, like this is the least, has the smallest variability because the optimist is most certain about in their, you know, their prior. So yeah, so certainty is sort of the antithesis of variability in this regard, right? So if you're certain, this is informative. Now, it's important. I think I'm not, maybe it doesn't say this exactly, but there's a difference between being informative and being right. You know what I mean? So just because you have, you know, obviously in this setup, you know, this optimist is not super right about me. So just, yeah, I don't know if that is helpful to anybody, but I was.
I agree. I don't love the term informative because it obviously like it sort of assumes that, you know, there's like some level of rightness and like, at least in terms of the optimist prior just seems like wrong, you know, like given like what we know.
Yeah. So what's really cool is, I mean, well, some people would say this is not cool, right? Because they hate people, anti-Bayesians would say this is not cool, but I think it's cool that people, you know, we get different answers, AKA different posteriors with different priors. And remember, these people have all the same data, right? So in the case of the feminist, you know, the prior is basically sort of like this, you know, it splits kind of almost like splits the difference between the prior, the posterior splits the difference between the prior and the likelihood, right? The clueless person is, there's just nothing really, I mean, you know, everything is just about the data, right? So the prior hasn't really been informative. It's vague. It doesn't really give us anything to hang our hat. So we get this sort of like symmetrical, almost over, you know, the 0.5 level. And then the optimist, you know, gets, what's interesting is it's more peaked, right? Well, actually, I don't know. Is it more? It's probably the same level of peaking.
Yeah, it's about the same.
Yeah,
eyeballing it.
I should say it's more. Is it leptokurtic or whatever you call it? More, whatever. I never talk like this. I just talk about peaks and. but you know, like all the stuff you learn, like you know, staff 101. So yeah, it's really cool that we get different answers or different, you know, posteriors. I shouldn't say the answers, but they're different sort of states of knowledge.
But, I also think what's kind of cool as well is that, like, take the optimist as an example, right? His prior was super left skewed, right? He is assuming that, let's say, like, his lowest plausible thing is 0.75, right? Movies past the Bechdel test. And that to me is like a really silly prior. But with the data, actually gets kind of to the same shape as the clueless right. And the feminist, which, you know, then you would think that, let's say you get even more data that, right. But then it's like, it doesn't really necessarily matter what your prior is because then the data is just going to swamp whatever your assumption is, which I find is like very interesting. Cause even though like the optimist has this like pretty incorrect prior, like given the data, it actually still has like the same type of shape, even if it's still slightly more optimistic, like for the value of pi compared to like, the clueless and the feminist.
Yeah, and maybe to follow up, like, you know, obviously this is only one set of data and we're going to talk about sequential sort of data runs, but like what if like tomorrow, the day after they do this, they do another sample of 20 movies and presumably if the what is it, like 0.4 or like 40% of movies passed or something like that, presumably if the data kind of, you know, stays the same and as we keep accruing more data and the same sort of like 0.4 value, I think, or whatever it was, this is going to move to the left, right? And if anything, the feminist as well, it's actually he or she is at, well, probably would move to the right a little bit. The clueless person just is like, whatever, dude. you know, there's nothing really helpful about this for us. Okay. Anyway, oh yeah, this might help a little bit. I don't know if this, well, yeah. So I like to use formulas just in terms of how to calculate the posterior beta function. So, you know, for the feminist, we just plug in, you know, the alpha level, which is for the feminist is 5 and you know, the number of successes is 45% point per play, right? And then, so anyway, this is how we get from our priors to our posteriors. And I like this. So I just copied it in. So at the opposite extreme is the clue. We started with a flat, vague prior model with pi. Absent any prior information, their posterior model directly reflects the insights gained from the observed model. And in fact, their posterior is indistinguishable from the skilled. Yeah, that's why we don't see it, I guess, is they're just overlapping. I guess there is like a blue to this line, I think, maybe. So
it's the same.
Same thing. So anyway, that was cool. I'm still like Rachel, I'm still like, okay, I couldn't just look at this and be like, wow, that's really meaningful.
Yeah, no, same.
I'm
awesome.
hopefully one day we'll get there. But for right now, I'm still just like, okay, it's interesting. I think I double copied this, right? So anyway, this is the same thing. I mean, this is just to show that, so let's be doing it. Okay, so this actually is, like I said, is my favorite part. I mean, I like the I think in some ways, as a psychologist in branding, I definitely think, you know, the prior, having different priors is really interesting, but also just, you know, having different data and a lot of it or not that much of it has such an impact, right? So one of the things that they do point out is the larger the sample size, the more insistent the likelihood, but I love that, right? So how is insistence being shown? Rachel, what do you think? What feature of this graph is reflecting the insistence? I love that.
Oh yeah, just like the more peakiness of
peakiness or more kurtotic or whatever the hell the word is, right? I love that, right? The this idea of insistence, it insists that it has to be here versus this dude is like, not really sure. Okay, so yeah, I dig that. So anyway, so I love these names are completely bonkers, right? Morteza, Nadine, I should say they're bonkers to me at least. So everyone has the same prior of 14.1, which is the optimistic prior, right, from the previous example. And the bigger our N, right, the more insistent our likelihood function, right? So interesting, right? So it doesn't, we're not changing the location of the likelihood, we're just changing the insistence or the peakedness, right? So this is just the same thing as before. So if I wanted to calculate Morteza, this is posterior beta function, I'm just plugging and chugging here. We have everyone has 14. Everyone has 1 for the alpha and the beta. She or he saw 6 successes and out of 13. Sorry. So everyone kind of understands that so far. And then lastly, this probably was also like a really interesting kind of table. I don't know if it feels like a figure, I should say. So each column is increasing amounts of data, and then each row is a differing prior, right? So this is the optimist, this is the feminist, and this is the clueless, right, or whatever. So the data's influence over the posterior increases with sample size. So our prior understanding, and I think you actually said this, right? Like this idea, as we get more data, you know, what we thought at the beginning just means less to us, or it holds less weight to our thinking going forward. So the rate at which posterior balances tips in favor of data depends on the prior. You know, the more informative the prior, the greater its influence on the posterior. So how do we denote informativeness? Anybody?
Probably more like less variance, right? Yeah, like less variance within the the prior.
Conks out sometimes.
Oh, yeah, now, wait, can you talk again? Sorry. Can't hear you. I don't know if Rachel can. Oh, now I can.
No.
Okay. Yeah. for some reason, like, I have these headsets that just, like, will just stop. Like, and, like, it won't even, like, blink or whatever. It'll just, or, like, a beep or whatever. So forgive me if that happens. Like, okay, sorry. Go ahead.
So, yeah, my thing was that it would be, at least, like, my interpretation of being, like, more informative is that it is, like, less variance, right, the distribution, as well as, like, it's, so it would be more centered around a smaller set of, you know, possible values, let's just say for pi, right, in this case.
Right. So if you notice, the insistence of, you know, the peakedness of these things keeps them together, whereas as we get less data, we have sort of less overlap, right? So there's, I would say this is close, these are closer together than this and that. So anyway, so I thought that was really interesting, right? This idea of, you know, just kind of showing these examples kind of gives us a nice thing. So, all right, so I'm going to kind of go through, because I want to spend time on some exercises, and I have to leave a little bit before top of the hour. So I didn't go into a ton of, but by the way, I'm going to propose that we don't need to go over this chapter again next week. I actually did the math, and I was like, well, if we do take 2 weeks to do every chapter, it'll take us 3/4 of a year or something to complete the book. That seems excessive. So I thought this was really interesting, right? This idea that, you know, like for Milgram's data, you know, the study we talked about last week, right? So, you know, on day zero, we just have, you know, this prior that kind of starts here, and then, starts here. And then as we go, we have increasing amounts of data. We get this sort of cumulative effect, right? They call it, you know, the there's two kind of properties of the sequential analysis, right? So the order of the data that it appears doesn't matter for the final decision, right? Now, obviously, it's going to change in the interim, because if you do, you know, this sample before that sample or vice versa, there's going to be, you know, changes in the interim, which that can be a real thing, I would imagine, if I was, you know, doing this. So it's invariant what order it happens in. But by the end, we're using all of this data to inform our posterior. So there was a bunch of math and a bunch of stuff related to this. I kind of just skipped over. I don't know if y'all had any, like, impressions or things you wanted to go over about this. But, I mean, I think this is, you know, fairly straightforward, right? Like, you know, we kind of accrue data, and so each data, you know, gathering gives us individual sort of samples to consider against our priors and what our posteriors from the previous data collections. But then at the end, we always end up with, whether we did this in a sequence of days or did it all at once, we still end up with the same, you know, final posterior model. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. And then lastly, I didn't say a lot about this, but I like this kind of idea of don't be stubborn. One of the ways to lose Bayesian benefits is by starting with an extremely stubborn prior model. A model so stubborn that it assigns the prior probability of zero to certain parameter values. So who would be someone who would be really stubborn in this examples that we've been doing? Anybody?
I think nobody. I think everyone assigned probability to each value. If I look
Sorry, didn't mean to cut you off. My bad.
No, if you want to contradict me, I was just thinking of these plots here, because their posteriors never go past what they allowed in the prior.
Right.
And since our feminist / clueless / whatever people, their posteriors are able to move.
Yeah.
Yeah, actually, that's fair. Yeah, yeah. I guess I was saying that maybe the stubborn one would be the optimist, only because it seemed that, like, they weren't even, considering, right? Like their range was, like, super high, right? I think it was, like, mostly, like, bounded from, let's just say, like, eyeballing it again, was, like, 0.75 to 1 for pi. And I was thinking, like, But actually, but then again, you bring a good point. It's like, even with that prior, the posterior, like, eventually gets to, like, a reasonable shape, which I guess then,
yeah.
But I guess then that they're only helped by then the data. So I guess if you don't necessarily have a the good amount of data, then maybe, like, you kind of mess up your analysis, right? Because, like, your prior is too rigid. But yeah, actually, no, I get what you mean, though, because it does shift.
I agree with you. Yeah, like the optimist is sort of, you can see how it wasn't really informative. Now, whether it's extremely stubborn to say, you know, nearly all movies passed the back, I don't know. I mean, I guess this is the hard part about this. Like, this is, you know, obviously this is a book about math and statistics, right? But this is probably the part of Bayesian sort of practice that's difficult to teach, right? I mean, you probably have to do it a lot. You probably have to have a lot of domain knowledge about, in this case, film and feminist, you know, or feminine representation and how they're represented and stuff like that, you know? And so if I'm just being an optimist because I don't know anything and I'm just like, hey, everyone should just be, you know, get along and let's all, I mean, that, yeah, that's sort of, I don't even know if it's stubborn, it's just ill-informed, you know what I mean? And so it's an interesting sort of dilemma, right, about how you come to some kind of a prior anyway. All right, so that's all I had in terms of the material. So I just wanted to, I just set up a couple of these things just to kind of for us to go through. We can go through it with the code or whatever. So which one of these do you guys think this which one of these is represented by one of these? So yeah, we have to match one of these to this. Any thoughts?
Plot beta binomial, and that's plot beta binomial.
Yep.
Yeah. Yep.
So beta, or just to go back, the beta needs to be higher than the alpha since the prior skewed to the left. So that cuts out a few of them.
Yep.
Right. Good point. So then so I'm clear. Rachel, you're saying these are out, right?
Because yeah, okay. And the last one too.
Good, I like this.
Nice, yeah, get those out of there.
It's all about exclusion. We can get rid of wrong. It's all about, yeah. Now
that's what this chapter's saying, yeah.
Exclude things.
Now we have a 33% chance. This is like taking the SAT back in the day. Like, you know, you get rid of like, you know, two bad answers, you get a 50% chance, right? In this case, we have a 33% chance of just by random chance. Okay, so, right. So, which one of these three do we like?
So, okay, I'm going to say the third one.
The third one.
So, it was a 50-50 chance.
Right. Good.
Yeah. I was thinking D, but yeah, okay. I was just thinking D. Yeah. Yeah.
All right. Well, Rachel, we're going to try yours because we got your first. I just wanted to make sure I include. Actually, you know, what am I doing? I can just copy and paste this entire string.
Well, that is nice.
Do you not use R, Rachel?
I don't use Markdown. I just throw everything in a script.
Oh, well,
this is yeah. Really slick. Yeah, I like this.
Yeah, it's nicer to do because it just allows you to kind of, yeah. So let's see.
That looks right. Yeah. No.
Let's just, by the way, just for due diligence here, let's.
Yeah, I'm curious what my choice looked at. Maybe, oh, yeah, because I guess the posterior is a bit wider. Yeah. Right. I think probably mine that I chose, I'm assuming. The variance is a bit, yeah, it's a bit.
Wow.
A bit more narrow.
That's really cool.
Got it. Yeah.
That's so interesting. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Interesting. Actually, let's do this. I want to just try. I don't know if this even make a difference. I mean, I just want to like see how this plays.
Yeah, and I guess that actually, yeah, Rachel, your choice makes more sense because with alpha, right, we're saying with y equals 2, the posterior shifts a little bit from the prior, but like not an insane amount. But with my choice, I'd be assuming that the posterior moves a lot more because like the peaks weren't touching, right? There's like some space in between. Okay.
Yeah, that's really cool. Well, good catch. I actually haven't even tried these. I only put this together this morning during a meeting. So.
Well, thank you. Right. I thought you did a really great job, Ryan.
Yeah. Well, I love copying and pasting. I mean, but I appreciate it. Thank you. All right. So this next one, I forget. This is just the next one. So this is kind of a weird example. Like, you know, this whole idea of like sampling, like whether or not an ice cream shop is open. It's like, okay, I guess, you know, well, I mean, obviously I'm assuming, actually, maybe we shouldn't assume that, you know, if you see an ice cream shop open at 2 p.m. on a Tuesday, that it might be open the next day. But given, you know, COVID and all of the, what do you call it, a lot of places I go to are closed now some days because they don't have enough employees, right? So maybe this example is more serious than I gave it credit for. So all these businesses consider the following story, local ice cream stores open. Sell runs of the ice cream for the day. Oh, yeah, okay, that makes sense. So this is probably more of a common thing that I'm realizing. It's 2 p.m. and wants to pick up an ice cream cone. And he asks, what about the chance of the ice cream cone? Okay, so this is their priors. So Kim Ya is what do we say about this person's attitudes about whether or not it's going to be open?
Slightly, I mean, it's not, it seems like it's like kind of weak, it's like a weekly informed prior, right? Like they're probably slightly more pessimistic about it being open, right? Because beta is larger than alpha, but they're not like putting a ton of weight right on it. So like, it's definitely not uniform, but it would be probably a bit more like right skewed, but probably still a bunch of variants.
Yeah, actually, so this is interesting. I didn't even try to do this, but like, so if I just use a beta function, and I don't even know if this is what I'm doing is so stupid, but let's just try this and see what happens. Okay, yeah, so it just gives you.
It just gives, right, it's, yeah. Whatever.
It just gives you the value for pi.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's kind of like coin flipping, right? Essentially. Yeah.
And then so let's let me just make sure I have all the answers so I don't keep coming back and forth. Yeah, you should try out Markdown, Rachel. This is like it's a good way to kind of do. Oh.
Yeah.
I've never thought about it.
I've been using it more at work lately. Just speak like I used to kind of hate working in notebooks, and then with like Python, I'd never really liked another IDE like at all. I've kind of flip-flopped a lot, but I kind of was like actually liked the notebook development, and then was trying it with R because usually I would just write it in scripts, and it's helpful for like certain things if I'm like doing any sort of like exploratory analysis and I want to like write notes, right? Because I feel like that's better than just writing a code comment.
Okay, so this is the 0.5 and 1, and this is the, oh, wow. So this person is, what is this person saying?
About a really low chance? But then yeah. I don't understand, because the second guy is a 2.
Yeah, so, yeah. I feel like, what if we, because used your functions, Ryan, like if we like visualized it, I think might just be,
I don't know how. Yeah. That's what I'm wondering is like. So I have to include the y.
Oh no, we could do. We could use the r beta function and just simulate. And just let's say you simulate like a million samples, right? With that shape, and then we can just plot it.
R beta function. Okay.
So yeah.
I've never used.
So it would be like r beta. The first argument is a number of samples, and then the second argument is alpha, and the third argument's beta. Yeah.
All right. Well, I'm going to do this. I'm not going to do a million because that might take a while. I'm sorry. So is this right then?
Yep. Yeah. And then that will just create a vector of 100. And then you could just like, you know, yeah, you could like just put that as like a tibble and then we could plot that.
Okay. All right. Yeah.
And
okay.
Then I
think I can just do this. Yeah.
Yeah. I think you can just do it. Yeah.
Ooh, wait a minute.
Oh, it would be, yeah, whatever. It would be hist. Do hist temp. Or like, I forget what base R would be, or like density.
Wait a minute. Oh.
Oh, sorry. Temp. Oh, it should be temp. Do dollar on temp.
Yeah, good point.
Okay. Yeah, that.
All right, my bad. Yeah.
Wow.
Interesting.
And then obviously, right, if you like be increased that, it would probably be, we'd probably get like a better idea. Honestly, if you even like put even a bunch of samples, like it'll actually run pretty fast.
Okay, let's do it. I'll do your.
Yeah.
Let's see how long. Here we go. Now we're running.
Too many zeros.
Hope I didn't crash your thing.
Too many zeros. Yeah.
That was the conspiracy to crash your machine now.
Yeah, no, that's right. No worries. Hold on. We'll give it a minute. But while it's working on that. Okay. Yeah. So then next thing we need to do is set up. Let's do this while this is running. I'll just take this. I thought it was going to be all slick by like doing like.
Oh, there we go. Yeah.
Yeah, it's actually not that different from the last one, though. I don't know. But it's fine. I mean, it's like, it's pretty clear. We have a nice, right? So we have a positive skew. And
so, yeah. It's probably less likely that it's open, right? Like with this prior.
Yes. Absolutely. All right, so let's, okay, so 3 out of 7, right? So we need to put 3 out of 7. And let's just stick with our friend 310, yes?
Yeah.
So this is our friend who says, I don't really believe that this is going to be, just gonna see if this runs without naming, okay. Oh, I forgot. Sorry. I was gonna plot this. Why I didn't care about a summary in this case. All right. So yeah, pretty cool.
What's the x-axis?
Oh, sorry. It's the pi.
Oh, it is very close to 50-50.
Yeah. Okay. So, because you know, 3 divided by 7 is, was it?
Yeah.
That number.
Right there, yeah.
You know yeah. The number.
Damn it. If I don't do the math, I'll be mad. Okay, yeah, so it's basically 43%, 0.643. Makes sense, right? That's where our peak is.
Yep.
And yeah, so like, so basically the prior is fighting the data, right? So we're moving things over to the right, and presumably if we go back the next week and count the number of days, this goes even further, right? Certainly this is a more insistent, likelihood. Remember that whole terminology from last time, or from a couple of slides ago, or whatever. I don't know if that makes sense, but yeah. Okay, so let's look at Kim Yaz. Yeah. Wow. So like. Still having a hard time interpreting the prior thing. So like, what are we saying? So basically he or she is saying this, it's highly unlikely that this anything is open, right? So the
data, yeah.
Yeah, and then.
And it scales down linearly.
Yeah. Now here's what's interesting, right? So I think this is interesting, right? So remember this whole idea of informative versus vague priors, right? So this is not an informative prior. So ultimately the posterior is a function of more of the data, right? Is that fair to say?
Yep.
Okay. Yeah, it's interesting. Okay. And then last one is, let's try 2 and 0.1. This person is what? Just before I put this in, what are we saying about this person? What is this person saying about the likelihood what's the prior and what's the relationship between the prior and the data before I push run?
Is it very likely that it's open?
Right. So either they really like ice cream or they have a lot of belief in ice cream, right? That is always available. Yeah. So here we go. This is like our optimist with the feminist.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. And so once again, this isn't really an informative prior as much, maybe, right? So interesting. What else? Okay. Which other? Okay. We already did 310, right? We already did.
I think we did all or most of them.
Dude, let's just do one more. So this is 0.5 to, is it to 1?
Yeah. To 1, yeah.
Okay, so this person is, first of all, the fact that alpha is less than beta tells us they're not very sanguine about the, you know, likelihood of an open ice cream shop. Yeah, same kind of the opposite deal here, right? And so... yeah, that's really cool. All right, so I'm almost out of time. So let me just do one thing. In each of the situations, we were given a beta prior for a pie and some binomial neutrality. So each scenario, identify which of the following is true. Prior has more influence. Oh, this is kind of like what we were just doing, right? Prior has more influence on the posterior. The data has more influence on the posterior, or they have equal, right? So here's the prior. And then here's what the actual data is saying. So we have 80% success, 0%, 33%, whatever. 10 divided by 13 is, y'all see what I'm doing here. So for this one, what do we say? Is it the prior is more influential or the data?
I was gonna say the data.
Rachel, what do you think?
Sure, I'd agree with that.
Sorry, I just need to like.
Oh, yeah, that's
fine. You're
that
doing
makes
good.
Sense. Yeah.
Okay, so we have 8 successes out of 10, yeah?
Yep.
Yeah.
So, okay, yeah, so, and what is this telling us? This is saying, well, actually, we don't even know what we're measuring. Let's just assume it's ice cream shops or whatever.
Yeah.
So,
it was
like,
skewed to the left again, right?
Yeah, right. Because
it's skewed to the right. Yeah.
Well, I mean, the prior is over here. And so, yeah. So what would we say? Is it the data or is it the prior? I think, you know, pretty clear. All right. Let me just copy all of these at one time. That way I don't have to dance around this. Okay. So 20 and 3. So this person is, once again, we're just talking about ice cream shops. So this person is saying, highly likely that the ice cream shop is open. But we have very little data, right? And it's not, so what would your guys' prediction be, just out of curiosity?
It's the prior takes over more, because like you don't really have any much data to change your, prior beliefs, right? Since you only have N equals one,
right.
It would like, which is kind of interesting. It actually shifts a bit more than I thought.
Yeah, I know. I was going to say the same thing. Like, I didn't even know what to expect, actually.
Yeah, because honestly, I was thinking that it would be kind of, it wouldn't really be discernible from the posterior really wouldn't be discernible from the prior distribution, right? It'd like be kind of like overlapping, but that actually is.
Yeah.
I thought
I was kind of agreeing with you there that you know that you think like this is actually one of the only bad things about Markdown is because you're mixing like HTML kind of stuff with it becomes this weird little behaviors. Okay, so now we have 4 and 2, so this is a more, you know, sort of this prior is a bit more rosier. And we have only, you know, 1 success out of 3. Okay. Interesting. So what's the takeaway here? What's been more informative, the prior or the data?
I suppose still the prior.
Yeah, I mean, it's almost, I would almost, because remember, the three choices are, you know, the prior has more influence, the data, or they're equal. And you can almost say it's kind of equal because it's in the middle, I guess.
Yeah. It seems like it's more of a compromise, right?
Yeah. I mean, I kind of agree with Rachel in the sense that it's like the, you know, it's leaning kind of more towards the yellow, the prior, but yeah, I don't know. I mean, I guess we'll see. Let me do a couple.
This is really interesting. Cool.
I know, yeah, it is. It's a really good way just to kind of like, you know, just working through this. It's better than, you know, I'm guilty of just agreeing things and then you think you understand it and you don't, you know. Okay, so now we have a very negative, or should say, you know, less probable, or less likely prior, and then we have a, you know, data that's like, wow, very different, right? So let's see what happens. Okay. I don't know, same deal, right? I mean, if anything, we'd probably, the last one we would give more to priors over data, but this is like perfectly symmetrical, yeah? I mean, you'd have to say. And then last one, 20 and 2, this person is expecting to see some damn ice cream shops, right?
Went there 200 times.
Yeah. They will be open. They will be open.
And we have a 5% chance based on the date that it's open. So yeah, this is
this is an
unhelpful prior. This person not, yeah. So that's actually really interesting. That's really cool. All right. Well,
I feel like I need to now reread about what they were saying with stubborn priors again, because like, even when you had like that last one seemed to me like a stubborn prior, like you are really certain that it's going to, that you're like the, for the parameter, it's going like it's an ice cream shops, right? You're like really certain that they're going to be open. And then we have data and it's like, no, you're wrong. And then now I'm like wondering, it's like, what does it really mean for it to be too stubborn, if that makes sense, right? I guess like maybe if the you have plots, like a really small amount of data, but I don't know.
The plots on chapter 4, section 6, don't be stubborn. It's their priors. There's absolutely zero probability past their prior. And so then it reflects in their posteriors. I don't know how you would write that though.
So are you talking about C? The C? I'm sorry, I misplaced you. So 4.7, is that what you're saying?
It's 4.6.
4.6. And then it's figure 4.7. That's.
Oh,
it is figure 4.7. Okay, that's right, yeah.
Okay. So
all three of these, I see. So these are all three are the same prior, but the data is just different, right?
No, so it's a quiz. So C is the correct.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. Okay. Good. I'm glad you said that because I was like, wait a minute. Oh, I didn't know. Okay, yeah. Because it's just not. Yeah. So this person is saying.
That's so weird. Such a bizarre shape.
So then, how would you be able to plot that with two numbers, saying that it's not your cutoff is 0.25?
So like in term, I think with plotting is like, so we assume, right, if I'm understanding this correctly, they're saying that pi follows a uniform 0.25 distribution. And I think in R, what you would just do is you'd use the R unif function, right? And then you would just generate, let's say, a large number, like a million, 10 million, yeah. Right? Whatever.
Oh, then filter out anything above 0.25.
No, what you would just do is you just directly plot it, I think, because you already have given the shape of the uniform distribution, right? So you're only saying that it's bounded between these two values.
I see what you're saying. Okay. Yeah.
Because like what it's like anything with like an R and then like a distribution. So like R unif, right? Like unif being uniform, R norm, R beta, R gamma, you know, all the types of the distributions. You're saying how many samples do I want from a distribution of this shape. So like if I did like R unif 100 0, 0.25. I'm like pointing on a screen as you can see it, but like you would say, I want 100 samples from a uniform distribution that follows 0, 0.25. And then you could plot that and you could, you know, get a better understanding of the shape. But what's so interesting is like that posterior is like so screwed. Like it's just so messed up. So I, like that makes more sense to me of like, but I wonder, does that then apply for like other types of priors, right? Like, because it seemed that when we had like a beta prior that was at least saying that there were certain values that were implausible, right, in this prior. But then it like the posterior like actually like shifted to something that was reasonable that looked like something a bit more where the where I would say like people had like better priors. But I wonder, does this only happen then with like uniform priors, or does this also happen with like other types of priors? If that made any sense, I'm kind of like rambling, but
No, I mean, I think those are good questions for next week. I got a chat actually. I'm sorry, I got something I had to jump on in like 2 minutes, but. Who's up next week? Anybody?
I will be out next week. I have a business trip, but I will be presenting chapter 6. I put it on the Google Doc sheet.
Rachel, can we put it on you, because otherwise there's nobody.
That's funny, because I will also be out of town.
Oh, well then maybe what we should do is
we could postpone it.
Yeah. Do that. Yep. So I will put in a note to our fearless leaders that we need to And then you can do chapter 5 the week after. Yes?
What was that?
Robert, can you still hear me? Sorry, did I cut out?
Oh, yeah. I could do 5. Yeah, I can also do 5, yeah.
Let's just do 5 2 weeks from today. Sounds good.
Yep, sounds good.
All right, y'all. A good week, and I will put in a note in Slack right now.
Thanks awesome. So
bye.
Great. Bye, guys.
See you guys. Bye.